各位法师，各位道友，大家晚上好。首先啊，请大家发菩提心。
Good evening, all teachers and Dharma friends. Let's begin tonight by arousing bodhicitta.
啊，今天我们要收皈依戒和居士戒啊。那么这个时候呢，我们尤其是要特别的要发菩提心。
Tonight we are going to take the refuge vows and the five lay precept vows too. So it's especially important this evening that we generate bodhicitta.
因为这个皈依，收皈依戒和这个收居士戒，对我们一个作为一个佛教徒来说。在我们的这个生命当中是一个比较重要的事情，所以这么一个重大的事情我们必须要不能离开这个菩提心。
Taking the five lay precepts and taking refuge as Buddhists is an extremely significant thing in the course of our lifetime. So it's important that in doing so, we do so with the motivation of bodhicitta.
那么菩提心呢？我们前几天每天都讲过了。为什么每天都要讲？为什么天天都要说菩提心呢？因为这个非常的重要啊。所以我们每天都要给大家提心啊。上次我给大家也讲过，比如说密宗里面的任何一个修法啊，包括就是一个几句话的这么一个很简单的仪轨，那么这个前面必须有一个皈依和这个菩提心发菩提心的这个集字，一定会有这么两句话，一个是皈依的另外一个就是发菩提心的集一定会有的，离不开的。
Just as over the past several evenings, I've continuously reminded everyone about the importance of generating bodhicitta, I'm going to do so again tonight. I've said in the past that regardless of how short a sadhana it may be, in Vajrayana Buddhism, every sadhana, without exception, begins with the taking of refuge and the generation of bodhicitta.
而且就像阿弥陀佛的修法、观世音菩萨修法等等金刚萨埵的修法，就有很简单的简略的这个修法，它只有一页只有一页，这个仪轨非常的短，只有一页，但是呢这个前面都有一个这个皈依和发心的机制。
Even one page sadhanas for practices, Amitama practices,Guanyin practices, Vajrasattva practices, they all begin likewise with the refuge and bodhicitta generation.
而且这个前面的皈依和发心，这个必须要重复三遍另外的这个仪轨呢，比如说他的这个修法，金刚萨埵的修法这个仪轨就只需要念一遍念一遍就可以了。但是呢，所有的仪轨都是这样子，前面的皈依必须要念三遍，然后呢菩提法菩提心的这个仪轨虽然只有一个偈子很短但是这个必须要重复三遍。
The refuge, the taking of refuge and the bodhicitta aspiration, even though they may be only one line in length, they have to be repeated three times.
为什么要重复三遍呢？因为变念这个机子，然后变相变发心变念变发心，整个衣柜都是这样子。但是呢，因为皈依和菩提心特别重要，所以呢必须要有足够的时间必须要有足够的时间没有足够的时间的话，那么这个皈依和发心尤其是发菩提心没有做好，那么后面的这个仪轨等于就是没有太大的意义，所以必须要念三遍的所有的这个密法的这些修法修心的仪轨都是这样子。
The reason why in all tantric sadhanas we repeat the refuge prayer and the bodhicitta aspiration three times is that we do this in order to have sufficient time to be able to recite the aspiration and also properly generate the aspiration in our minds. If we only repeated the lines once, then this wouldn't necessarily give us enough time to truly generate the quality of aspiration in our mind. So it's given the importance of refuge and bodhicitta in terms of the entire sadhana. This is why we repeat it three times. If we don't properly generate the refuge prayer and the aspiration of bodhicitta, then the rest of the sadhana doesn't amount to much.
在密法密法里面讲过了，比如说念咒，念了很多很多咒不是一万两万就是几亿两个亿三个亿这么多的心咒然后修本尊就是 亲眼见到了这个本尊，不是在我们自己心里想，而且就是我们见到我们的一个熟悉的人一样的亲眼见到本尊啊，然后就是等等啊，还有就是施术的这些啊，这个施间的成就，就是神通啊等等，这些都成就了，都有啊，但是唯一就是两个东西缺乏了，一个是菩提心，另外一个就是真悟空心的坚定。只要没有这两个，那么我们念的咒再多啊，观相本尊观相的再清楚，然后呢修禅定修的啊，我们的心再平静也好，这些都是不解决最根本的问题。最根本的问题就是生死的问题。
The tantric scriptures are clear that even if we do recitations of root mantras in the millions, even if we are able to visualize our idam deities with such clarity that we can virtually see them in all their detail, even if we're able to do these things and attain special powers, etc., lacking the two conditions of bodhicitta and a realization of emptiness, then ultimately all of our other attainments, regardless of whatever kind of meditative levels of meditative absorption we might reach, ultimately these don't address any real problems. They don't really address the core problem of our cyclic existence.
密宗的任何一个本尊的这个修法我们刚才前面讲的很短很短的，很简短简略的一页甚至是半页甚至几句话的一个这样子的仪规都以前面都有皈依和发心，而且这个皈依和发心要念三遍，其他的仪规只需要念一遍。由此可见密宗它多重视这个菩提心。
So the fact that in any tantric sadhana, regardless of its length, from a very short page, one page sadhana to a sadhana of even only a few lines, the fact that we repeat the refuge prayer and the bodhicitta aspiration three times, whereas the rest of the sadhana we only repeat once, indicates very fully how important the Vajrayana tradition regards the taking of refuge and the generating of bodhicitta.
密法它由藏传佛教的密法就分两种密法，一个叫做外密，另外一个叫做内密内密也叫做无上密宗藏传佛教的密宗就这么分两种层次。
The Tibetan Vajrayana tradition divides the tantra into two types, the inner tantra and the outer tantra.
然后汉传佛教也有密宗，汉传佛教的密宗就叫做唐密，唐朝的时候翻译的密宗，也有很多的这个密宗的经典就是徐补。
The Chinese tradition also has tantric teachings, tantric scriptures. These are referred to as Tang Tantra. These are scriptures or texts that were translated during the Tang Dynasty.
然后日本的佛教也有密宗，这个就叫做东密。东密就是中国唐朝翻译的这个汤密，最后就是传到日本就叫做东密。
And Japan also has a tradition of tantra. These tantras were also translated during the Tang Dynasty, and we refer to these as the Eastern Tantra.
这个汤密和东密在藏传佛教的密宗里面就叫做外密，实际上这三个都是一个意思。藏传佛教讲的外密汉传佛教的唐密，日本的东密，实际上就是不同的名称，实际上都是一个内容。
So the Eastern Tantra referred to in the Japanese tradition, and the Tang Tantra referred to in the Chinese tradition, and the Outer Tantra referred to in the Tibetan tradition are all essentially describing the same thing in essence.
那么另外一个叫做无上密宗，无上密宗呢，全世界只有在这个早期的时候呢，只有在藏文上面有，其他的文字上面呢，因为印度以前有，但是后来也就是印度的佛教这个衰败的时候呢，都这些经典都已经不见了但是现在有中文版，也有英文版，也有很多早起的时候呢只有藏文里面才有这个内密。
But in terms of the inner tantra, this is something that only the Tibetan tradition has preserved. Of course, now there are translations in English, in Chinese, in various languages, but the original Indian scriptures of these tantras were destroyed many centuries ago.
那么这个藏传佛教里面的无上密宗就是内密，号称是整个佛教里面的这个最高境界精华但是呢，如果没有菩提心的话也不行的，如果没有菩提心的话，这个无上密宗也不能解决问题的，也不能解决我们的生死的问题。
Even though the inner tantra represent the highest teachings of the Buddhist tradition, without bodhicitta, then these teachings themselves also lack the capacity to address our real problems.
所以我们最终的目标当然是要学，比如说禅宗或者是内无上密宗的大圆满大收音这样子的这个非常深奥的很高深的这个佛法但是呢最关键的，尤其是我们目前最需要的，最最需要的就是出离心和菩提心。我们每一次这个修行的时候，大家一定要提醒自己这几天呢，我们讲课的时候呢，我给你们提醒提醒大家发菩提心，然后以后自己修行的时候呢，要给自己提醒自己提醒自己我一定要发菩提心，这样子每次都要发菩提心，这样子的话，那么我们的所有的修心都会成为大乘的这个大乘的山根，大乘的佛法密宗，也就是其中的一部分。
Even though our ultimate goal in practice is to engage in chan practice, in the inner tantric teachings of the Dzogchen tradition and the Mahamudra tradition, what we need most, at least at this current point in time, and in fact what is the most important foundation, is renunciation and bodhicitta. So for these past several days, I've been reminding everyone of the importance of these things, and I hope that subsequently in your own practice that you remind yourself of the importance of generating renunciation and bodhicitta. With the aspiration of bodhicitta, then all of the practice we do will constitute merit and virtuous action in accordance with the teachings of the Greater Vehicle.
如果我们没有发菩提心的话，守菩萨戒根本就得不到真正的这个菩萨戒。菩萨戒就是需要有菩提心的基础才能够得菩萨戒。
Without a genuine cultivation of bodhicitta, then it's not possible for us to take the bodhisattva vow. The very basis, the foundation of the bodhisattva vow is genuine cultivation of bodhicitta.
所以没有出离心的话呢，比如说像我们守出家人的戒律等等这些戒律，如果没有守，没有如果没有这个标准的这个出离心的话，就是得不到这个真正的出家人的这个戒律，只能得到一个相似的就是相似的意思，就是比较接近这个佛教这样的戒律。但是这个戒律因为它的基础不是这个出离心，所以呢这个戒律跟外道的戒律是没有太大的区别外道也有很多的戒律 他们的戒律当中也有很多很多都是非常好的，比如说不杀生、不偷盗啊，古老的这些宗教里面都有的。所以这跟我们的这个戒律有什么区别呢？是没有办法分的。所以呢，必须要有皈依和这个出离心的基础。有了这个基础以后，这个戒律就是佛教，就是属于佛教讲的戒定慧当中的戒啊，否则的话就是不属于的。
Similarly with ordained vows, without a proper foundation of renunciation, then even though we may take the vows, essentially what we are receiving is only an approximation. It's important that we have a generation, that we have bodhicitta as our foundation in taking vows. Other religious traditions also have various kinds of precepts and disciplinary vows. For example, precepts against killing, precepts against stealing, etc. However, what distinguishes Buddhist vows in this context are the foundation of refuge and renunciation and bodhicitta. So this underscores the importance of these.
所以我们要修出离心和菩提心，这个就是佛教的基础啊，也就是佛教的这个核心的思想。没有这些，然后我们平时烧烧香、拜拜佛，这个真的是不能解决任何的问题。当然，这个比不信佛好啊，比不信佛好。这样子，我们至少对佛有一个恭敬心啊。那我们当然这个就是比不信佛好，但是这个。也不能让我们解脱，也不能让我们成佛，所以我们这一次呢，就是好不容易有一个这样子机会的时候呢，大家一定要抓住佛教的这些核心的东西。
So it's extremely important that we work on the cultivation of renunciation and bodhicitta, and rather than simply engaging in making incense offerings and superficial observations of Buddhist activity. While, of course, it's better to do this, it's better to have faith in Buddhism than no faith at all. It's better to do these things than nothing. The fact that we have this precious human existence, we should really take advantage of it to study Buddhism properly, because such superficial observations are not going to help us in attaining Buddhahood, and they're not going to help us in attaining liberation.
所以我们要实修啊，需要实修啊。比如说我们很多人呢，很多学佛的人呢，就根本就不去听法，不去学习，只是烧香拜佛而已。然后呢，学了以后呢，我们只是学一学佛教的这些理论啊，学一学佛教的知识。不去实修啊，这样子的话呢，虽然懂了很多道理，但是我们做不到。很多人也说啊，这个理论我懂，这个不能做，那个可以做，这个什么不好，这个什么好，我都知道，但是我做不到。很多人就是这么啊，很多人都是这样子。为什么做不到呢？这个很正常的，理论上我们都知道的，学了以后大家都知道，不学当然理论上都不懂啊。学了以后我们都知道，但是做不到，做不到就是因为我们的修心不到位，我们还没有训练，所以没有去训练，没有去锻炼啊。用佛教的话来讲，就是没有去修心，所以做不到。
And it's very important that we really concretely practice the teachings. Whilst there are some people who don't practice at all, they simply stop or at the level of making offerings, etc. There are those who do study the teachings but don't put them into practice or aren't able to put them into practice. And the reason for this is that they don't engage in proper practice. And for this reason, whilst they might understand in theory what they're meant to do, what they're not meant to do, they're not able to actually implement it in their lives.
如果我们想啊，我们所学到的，我们想做到啊，这样子的话，那就是要修心啊，修心才能够达到这个目的。
If we really want to be able to implement all that we learn, then it's very important that we do engage in practice. This is the only thing that will help us in achieving this goal.
所以希望大家好好的修 啊，比如说我们可以在这个昨天也讲过了，菩提学会啊，里面也有很多很多的非常系统的这个课程啊，可以学。嗯，然后如果我们喜欢简单一点的，不要不像没有时间学这么多的东西，但是要实修的话，那就是在这个慧灯禅修班啊，这个里面呢。也有这从这个出离心到菩提心，最后禅定啊，最后这个空心这些啊课程啊都会有的。目前这个里面就有四加心和五加心的这个四加心、五加心还有禅定的修法。但是呢，这个我们要一步一步，可能需要五六年的时间啊，一步一步完成。啊，参加这个小组也可以的啊。或者是自己家里啊，不参加任何的这个学习的小组，就自己家里修啊，也是可以，都可以的。
I really urge everyone to sincerely commit themselves to practice. In order to do this, there are many classes and groups that we can take advantage of. The Puti Xiaozu, for example, they have a very systematic curriculum that students can follow. For those who want a slightly simpler or practice-oriented curriculum, then the Huideng Changxiu Ban is also an option.At present, there is only a curriculum on the preliminary practices and also some meditation instruction as well. But the curriculum will be gradually increased over the course of 5 or 6 years. If one wants to study and practice at home too, this is clearly also an option.
然后这个占山金蛇，刚才大一法师说他们下一个月或者具体的时间我不知道，也有禅修啊，有一个期的这个一个禅期，禅宗啊，就是每七天就是作为一个这个阶段，然后修一个期、两个、三个、五个、七个这样子，有传统上都是这样子，非常好的啊。然后到时候有时间的话。大家啊，尽量的参加这个禅期，然后呢，禅期修行的时候呢，修行的内容啊，这个可能是这个占山金舍也许有啊统一的安排，或者是自己修出离心、菩提心啊、空心、禅定都可以的。但是呢，就在这个道场里面，大家一起修的话，那就是由。这个大家聚在一起修的话，相互之间啊，大家可以鼓励啊，然后就是监督等等有作用啊。否则的话，我们一个人在家里修的话，那有些时候想修的时候修，不想修的时候，尤其喝喝茶、看看电视啊，就看看手机，大部分的人这样子以后呢，就是。就修不下去的。这在道场里面修的话，那就是有严格的要求，就效果是非常好的。
Another option is here at Jiangshan Jingshi, which from next month will be implementing a Chan meditation program revolving around a traditional curriculum of 7-day meditation sessions. So this is another option that students can take advantage of.The benefit of coming to an actual Dharma space and benefiting from the fact that one's fellow Dharma students can assist in monitoring each other and encouraging each other. Often when we practice at home, it's very easy to become distracted and lay aside our practice and do other things, look at our mobile phone, etc.
如果我们这样子一步一步修的话比如说如果我们下一次来的话加入来的话，那么比如说出离心修完了，那出离心修完了以后呢，就可以讲菩提心了，菩提心的具体的这个修法。如果菩提心修完了，然后呢可以修即下一个这个修法一步一步就根据大家的进度这样子修的话对大家都有帮助的否则的话，如果每年来也就是这样子一些佛教的一些知识佛教的一些这些大中华的知识给大家讲一讲大家也不修，那么这样子就是没有太多的实际的作用所以大家这个个人修也好，大家集中修也好， 就在这个道场里面修，但是道场的这个禅期呢，只有一个期，不可能不可能一直都在道场其实道场可以修，然后其余的时间呢，就是我们每周就是上次讲的一样，就在师兄的家呀，或者这样子的道场，也应该是可以提供放这个场地的或这样子修。然后平时呢，每一天都在自己的家里修。那这样子的话，我们的修行是有帮了，有进步的。这样子我们对修行也会越来越感兴趣，因为看到自己的进步看到自己的进步的时候呢，我们对修行是充满信心的这样子是非常好的。
So it's important that we practice like this, gradually, stage by stage. First, cultivating bodhicitta, renunciation, then moving on to bodhicitta, and then moving on to the next stage of practice. This has benefit for us in terms of providing a common level of practice, so that teachings can be appropriately tailored to this level. Otherwise, we just have a situation where every year the teacher comes, gives general teachings on Buddhism, and ultimately doesn't assist people in their practice in their progress if people aren't practicing themselves. So, for example, everyone can take advantage of the 7-day chan sessions here, but of course, it's not possible to spend one's entire time in the Dharma Center environment. So, one also has to continue one's practice in one's home space or in the home of other Dharma companions. And it's through persisting in practice this way that students can see and perceive their own results in practice. And as a result, they will become more inspired to practice and more, in fact, interested in their own practice.
否则的话，这个课非常非常难讲不知道怎么讲。比如说，我们幼儿园的学生、小学的学生、中学学生、大学学生，大家都聚在一起，让你讲一个课，怎么讲呢？没办法讲了不知道怎么讲，就是这样子。我们层次不齐，怎么讲？大家的层次都不齐，所以课也没有办法这个讲讲了以后呢。就是我们不修的话，对每个人的这个利益帮助也不是很大。
If everyone isn't at a similar level, then it's extremely difficult to tailor the teachings to everyone's needs. How can you give a lecture, for example, if you're addressing an audience comprised of kindergarten, elementary, high school, and university students? It's very difficult. At the same time, if teachings are given, but everyone doesn't actually practice them, then ultimately it's very difficult for the teachings to be of true benefit.
如果我们按照这个次第去修的话，比如说我们有100个人、200个人，初离心已经修得差不多了，那么你们可以在这个任何一个地方，因为这边有很多很多的上师呀、师父都有的就是邀请他们给他们讲，我们已经把这个初离心修好了，来给我们讲一下菩提心的修法。那完全是可以的呀，他们来给你们讲一个菩提心的修法，然后大家又去修，修完了以后呢，然后再下一个这个课程，这样子一步一步修那么最后我们能够修到禅定和这个修到这个大圆满的空心，这些佛教的比较高端的这些课程。
If we approach our practice in this step-by-step fashion, then after we have practiced renunciation and cultivated renunciation, it's possible for us to find a teacher. There are many available in the Toronto area, and ask them, based on the fact that we have cultivated renunciation, ask for teachings on bodhicitta, for example. And then, receiving teachings on bodhicitta, we can practice these and then gradually move on to other practices. So, it's by following this gradual step-by-step progress that we will then ultimately study meditation techniques and move on to advanced teachings like the Tsultrim practices.
否则的话，我们永远都没有办法修到像禅宗还有大圆满大手印这样子的高深的法 即使是我们没有啊，没有修这些出离心和菩提心的基础上，有人跟我们传了啊，但是也没有用的，就是因为没有这些基础，就是不能证悟。所以有人即使是有人传了，我们去修了也是没有用的啊。所以修心的这个次第是非常非常重要，就是就像我们工作啊、生活啊。是任何一个事情都是有一个他自己的次第啊，先后的顺序啊，只要这个顺序没有错，一步一步啊修都有一个结果，任何事情都会有一个结果。
Unless we do follow this proper steps of progress, then it won't be possible for us to ultimately practice the higher teachings of the Dzogchen tradition and the Chan tradition, for example. Even in fact, if we were to receive instruction on these teachings without the proper foundations in the essential steps of renunciation and bodhicitta, etc., then these instructions, these teachings wouldn't be of much use to us. It's the same in really any aspect of life, in terms of our work, etc. Every endeavor has its proper stage of progress, and it's by following the proper stages, as long as they are, there's nothing wrong, intrinsically wrong with the stages themselves, by properly following these stages, we'll necessarily reap results.
我知道我们很多很多的居士啊都是非常的虔诚的啊，很多人都是真心想学佛的，真心想修行的，这个我们非常的了解啊。但是呢，很多人都是就是不知道怎么样去学习，就是不知道这个学佛到底要怎么学，怎么去修啊，就是不清楚啊。所以呢，我们啊应该有一个这个实际行动，从现在开始。从人生难得啊，一步一步的修，这样子的话，那么我们啊，一定能够修出一个结果啊，这样子是非常有意思的。
I'm fully aware that there are many very sincere Buddhist practitioners or people with Buddhist faith who really want to engage in practice.However, they don't know where to start. They don't know how to properly go about being a student of Buddhism. So we really need to start with concrete actions from this point in time. Begin with contemplation on the preciousness of human existence and starting here step by step, one step at a time, concretely and apply ourselves to the proper stages of practice.
好，接下来啊，我们就讲这个今天的这个主体的课程，就是皈依啊。那我们首先受皈依和受这个居士戒之前，要给大家介绍一下啊，什么叫做皈依戒，什么叫做这个居士戒，这个要给大家讲一讲。
So we're now going to move on to the core of tonight's teaching, which is the taking of the refuge vows, the taking of the lay precept vows.However, before we take the vows, I'd like to explain to everybody what these vows entail.
首先，什么叫做皈依呢？皈依就是正式进入佛门的一个简单的仪式，叫做皈依。
So, refuge, in essence, is a simple ceremony that marks the formal entrance into the Buddhist path.
正式进入佛门的意思是什么呢？比如说我们还没有受皈依戒之前啊，我们烧香拜佛啊，然后就是有相信佛、相信因果、相信轮回啊，平时都心善，但是呢，这个时候还不叫佛教徒啊。为什么不叫佛教徒呢？还没有进入佛门啊，那我们已经烧香拜佛，相信佛，相信佛法，为什么还没有进入佛门呢？进入佛门就是皈依了以后呢，才叫做进入佛门啊。凡是没有皈依的，没有皈依的人，都还没有真实的进入佛门啊。所以这个皈依就是正式进入佛门的一个。简单的仪式啊，有一个我们最后有一个简单的仪式。
When we talk about formally entering into the Buddhist path, What this means is that before we take refuge vows, even though we may have faith in the Buddha, we may believe in the karmic law of cause and effect, we may engage in virtuous and positive conduct, but until we've actually taken the refuge vow, we are not considered formally, we're not considered genuine students of Buddhism, we're not considered genuine Buddhists. It's after we take the refuge vow, which is marked by a simple ceremony, that we are considered genuine students of Buddhism.
好，这是第一啊。第二啊，皈依啊，今天我们皈依啊，皈依的时候皈依谁呢？啊，这个我们的皈依处叫做皈依处。皈依处是谁呢？这是皈依佛、皈依法、皈依僧啊，佛、法、僧。在佛教里面就叫做三宝啊，三宝就是我们今天的皈依处啊。我们皈依谁呢？就是皈依佛、皈依法、皈依僧。
We also need to establish what the objects of our refuge are. Our objects of refuge are referred to as the three jewels, and they are the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha.
我们很多很多的这个佛教徒啊，就有一个普遍的现象啊，普遍的现象是什么呢？比如说我今天给你们守这个皈依戒的话，那么很多人以为是皈依我啊，有很多人都是这么普遍就这么认为，但是其实不是这样子啊，我是来帮你们做这个仪式啊，皈依的仪式啊。我来帮你们做皈依的仪式，实际上不是来皈依我的，我们都是皈依佛、皈依法、皈依僧啊，并不是皈依某一个人啊，不是皈依某一个人。如果我们只皈依某一个人，其他都不皈依啊，那么这样子的话，这个就叫做个人崇拜，所以这个不叫皈依。
There's a widespread phenomenon whereby many students think that by taking the refuge vows in the presence of a particular teacher, they are actually taking refuge in that teacher. This is not the case. The teacher in whose presence one takes the refuge vows is simply enabling you to take refuge in the triple gem, the Buddha, the Dharma, the Sangha. If we were to take refuge in one person at the exclusion of the triple gem, then essentially we would be engaging in a kind of worship of an individual person.
好，那么三宝啊，三宝是什么呢？首先佛简单的说啊，简单的说，如果我们很深入的、细致的、展开的讲。那就是佛发生，就是非常非常内容非常的丰富的。但是我们简单的说，佛就是啊，释迦牟尼佛、阿弥陀佛、药师佛等等啊，十方的三世的三世，就是过去、现在、未来的佛，所有的佛就是我们的这个归处，这是第一个。第二个法就是所有的法，凡是释迦牟尼佛所说的法，所传下来的法啊，不管是南传的、汉传的、藏传的，或者是小乘的、大乘的、密宗的、贤宗的，凡是释迦牟尼佛所说的法，都叫做法宝。这个就是我们的第二个皈依处。
It's possible to talk about.Each of the objects in refuge in great detail. However, tonight we'll just outline them simply. The first object of our refuge is the Buddha. And the Buddha, putting it simply, refers to all the Buddhas, the Sakyamuni Buddha, Amitabha Buddha, the Medicine Buddha, the Buddhas of all 10 directions, the Buddhas of all 3 times. Buddha refers to all the Buddhas. The second object of our refuge is the Dharma.The Dharma refers to all of the teachings of the Buddhist tradition, regardless of whether they belong to the Southern School, Chinese Buddhism, Tibetan Buddhism, Mahayana Buddhism, Hinayana Buddhism, Sutric Buddhism, Vajrayana Buddhism, all of the teachings of the Buddhist tradition are encompassed in the refuge object of the Dharma.
第三个皈依除就叫做僧啊，僧宝。僧宝是什么呢？从大乘佛教的角度讲，像文殊菩萨啊、观世音菩萨、地藏王菩萨等等啊，就是一尊菩萨也叫做僧啊，也叫做僧众。嗯，从小乘佛教的角度讲，就是四个人以上的这个僧众的团体，比如说四个比丘啊、四个比丘尼等等啊，就是四个人以上的出家人的团体叫做僧众。
And the third object of refuge, the Sangha. From the point of view of the Mahayana tradition, the Sangha includes all of the bodhisattvas, Manjushri, for example, Kshistibaba, all of the bodhisattvas are encompassed in the Sangha. In the Theravada tradition, the Sangha refers to any community, any monastic community of four ordained persons,or more, regardless of whether they be monks or nuns.
啊，这个就叫做这个皈依除啊，大家要清楚，要明白，我们今天皈依谁呢？就是皈依这三个，就皈依佛、皈依法、皈依僧。嗯，然后呢，密乘里面呢，有些时候就说皈依四皈依，四皈依就是皈依佛、皈依法、皈依僧、皈依上师啊。但是呢，实际上上师就已经包含了这个僧啊、僧众里面，所以这个分和不分都是一个意思。所以呢，三皈依跟四皈依实际上就是一个意思。
So these are the three objects of our refuge: the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha. In the Vajrayana tradition, we also speak of a fourth object of refuge, the Guru. However, in actual fact, the Guru is already encompassed in the third object of refuge, the Sangha. So regardless of whether we talk about three objects of refuge or four objects of refuge, it's all the same.
啊，这个是第二、第三啊，第三是这个皈依的本质啊，到底什么叫做皈依呢？啊，皈依是不是烧香拜佛呢？不是啊，烧香拜佛不是皈依啊。那我们是不是啊，皈依佛、皈依法、皈依僧，念这个皈依的这皈依的这个偈子啊，是不是皈依呢？也不是，也不一定是啊。然后那我们是不这个诵经啊、念咒啊，这些是不是皈依呢？也不是，这些都不叫皈依。
So the next thing we need to establish is what is the essence of taking refuge? Is it making an incense offering and propitiating the Buddha? Is it reciting the refuge, the lines of refuge? Is it reciting the sutras and doing things like this?
然后我们比如说那皈依的时候呢，会发皈依证啊，发一个证件啊。那这个是不是皈依呢？也不是，嗯，然后皈依的时候也可以取一个法名啊，取一个佛教的名字啊。那么这个是不是皈依呢？也不是，这些都不是皈依啊。那么这些都不是皈依，那到底皈依是什么呢？啊，皈依的本质大家必须要清楚，皈依的本质就是一种决心啊，下决心啊，或者是一种选时啊，我们今天这里有释迦牟尼佛的佛像，后面也有释迦牟尼佛的佛像，这就是代表佛陀啊。那我们在释迦牟尼佛的佛像前啊，很庄严的、很严肃的要选时啊，这个宣誓或者是这个决心叫做皈依。
Taking refuge is none of these things, nor is it obtaining a refuge certificate or receiving a Dharma name. The essence of taking refuge is a commitment, a pledge, or a resolution. Tonight we have an image of the Buddha, and so it is essentially the very sincere resolution or pledge that we make before the image of the Buddha.
好，然后我们啊，宣誓是皈依，那宣什么誓呢？啊，下什么决心呢？啊，所以我们啊，大家现在我们我边讲，你们大家就心里啊做好准备啊。第一个，我们皈依佛啊，皈依佛的时候呢， 我们要下决心啊，在释迦牟尼佛的佛像前面，我们很庄严的啊，很严肃的啊，也就是用心去这个发宣誓、发誓或者是下决心啊。那下什么决心？第一个，我们皈依佛的时候呢，我们下决心，我从今天起啊，生生死死乃至成佛之间啊，释迦牟尼佛作为我的唯一的导师啊。导师是什么？引导我们的上师，引导我们的老师，叫做导师。释迦牟尼佛、阿弥陀佛、药师佛等等，佛就作为我的唯一的导师啊。除了佛以外啊，任何一个，比如说鬼神啊等等啊，这些都不作为啊我的导师。这样子下决心宣誓啊，这个宣誓下决心就叫做皈依佛。真正的皈依就是这个。
So as to what genuine refuge is, I'm going to walk you through the steps of each refuge object one by one, starting with the refuge in the Buddha. So before an image of the Buddha, a Buddha statue, we sincerely generate the commitment, or we make the pledge, we make the promise that from this day onwards until the day of our enlightenment, we rely on one master, the Buddha only. And until the day of our enlightenment, we will rely on no other spiritual guides.
第二个皈依就是皈依法，皈依佛法啊。那么皈依佛法的时候呢，我们同样的啊，就是啊，庄严的、严肃的下决心宣誓，宣什么样的誓？就是说，我从今天起，那生生死死乃至成佛之间啊，只修释迦牟尼佛的法啊，只修佛法，不修邪门外道的法啊，这样子下决心，这个就叫做皈依法啊。那么这个法当中呢，我们刚才已经讲过了啊，小乘的、大乘的、显密，所有凡是佛法都在这个里面啊。凡是佛法都在里面，所以我们下决心，我只修佛法，不修邪门外道的法，这样子下决心，这个叫做皈依法。
And the second object of refuge is the Dharma. Similarly to taking refuge in the Buddha, we solemnly make the pledge that from this day onward until the day of our enlightenment, we will train in accordance with the Buddha Dharma only.We will not train in accordance with the teachings of other religious or spiritual traditions. And as I outlined before, when we talk about the Buddha Dharma, this refers to the entire teachings of the Buddhist tradition, regardless of their vehicle or the region from which they originate.
然后第三啊，皈依僧的时候呢，也是啊，同样的要下决心。我们大家每个人现在就心里做好准备，要下这样子下决心啊！我从现在起，生生死死啊，学释迦牟尼佛法的僧众，无论是大乘的还是小乘的啊，凡是学释迦牟尼佛法的僧众，就是作为我的唯一的道友啊。道友是什么呢？跟我们一起修道的学佛的人叫做道友啊，作为我的唯一的道友。除了学佛的人以外，修邪门外道的人啊，不作为我的道友啊，他们有可能是我的战友、学友、朋友都有可能，但是不是我的道友啊。这样子下决心啊，这个叫做皈依僧。
And when we take refuge in the third of the triple gem, the Sangha, we similarly solemnly pledge that from this day onwards, for all of our lives until we achieve enlightenment, we will train in accordance with the example of the Buddha Sangha only. So this includes both the Sangha.In the Mahayana tradition and in the Hinayana tradition as well. So this means that We look upon the Buddha Sangha as our only spiritual companions. While we may have friends in other avenues of life, friends, good friends, school friends, friends in other contexts, our spiritual companions, we only look upon fellow Buddhists as our spiritual companions.
简单的说，皈依就是一种承诺，比如说一个学生到某一个学校去读书的时候，他要承诺，这个学校给我安排的老师，我承认，他是我的老师，然后呢，这个学校给我安排的这个课程，我就承诺我学，我认认真真的学，然后呢，学校给我安排的这个其他的同学，其他的学生，我承诺他们是我的这个同学，我接受这些，我承诺这些，这样子以后呢，这个人就是属于这个学校的学生当中的一员，同样的，我们有了这样子的承诺的时候呢，才叫做佛教徒，否则的话，比如说我们，我也不跟着释迦牟尼佛学，我也不一定跟他学，我也不一定这个学佛教，然后我也不一定要把这个学佛的人当作我的道友，这样子的话怎么可能叫做佛教徒呢？不叫佛教徒，我们偶尔去烧烧香拜拜佛，这个谁都可以做的，这不叫佛教徒。
So putting it simply, we can regard refuge, taking refuge as a kind of pledge or promise. Just as when a student enters a new school, this entails a recognition of the teachers at the school as one's teachers. It entails a recognition of the curriculum as a curriculum one is prepared to follow and study. It also entails a recognition of the other students at the school as one classmates. And it's through recognizing, accepting these three things that one becomes a legitimate student. Similarly, becoming or taking the refuge vows is how we become a genuine Buddhist. If we are not necessarily prepared to follow the example of the Buddha, if we're not necessarily willing to study the Dharma or regard other Buddhists as our spiritual companions, then even though we might engage in other kinds of superficial Dharma conduct, this doesn't amount to much. Anybody can do these things. It's through taking refuge that we become a genuine Buddhist.
好，第四啊，第四，为什么我们学佛要皈依呢？这个理由是什么呢？理由，首先我们要知道我们学佛，什么叫学佛？这个我们前几天都已经讲过很多次了啊。学佛就是向释迦牟尼佛的慈悲心，向释迦牟尼佛的智慧学习啊，这个叫做学佛。
So next we need to look at the reason for refuge, why we take refuge as students of Buddhism. Over the past few days, we've talked many times about how being a student of Buddhism means to follow in the example of the Buddha and to study his compassion and his wisdom.
我们学佛，我们向释迦牟尼佛的智慧和慈悲心学习的话，那我们需要几个学习的条件。比如说一个学生读书的时候呢，他有几个最基本最关键的学习的条件那么这个学习条件是什么呢？第一个这个学校里面呢需要有很好的老师如果没有老师他就是没有办法学习，所以他需要有老师第一。第二这个学校虽然有非常优秀的这个老师，但是呢，学校不给他安排任何的学习的课程这样子的话也没有用的，所以需要有学习的内容然后第三呢我们进入这个学校就需要有很多人的帮助家长的帮助，然后呢，进去了以后呢，同学的帮助以及其他学校的工作人员的帮助等等，需要很多的帮助。只要有这三个条件有老师，有学校的这学习的课程，然后有家长同学的帮助，这样子这三个就是他的最基本的条件，这样子他就可以学习。
So whilst we're to be students of the Buddha's wisdom and compassion, there are several basic conditions that we need to have in order to be this kind of student. like a student in a regular school, without a teacher, without proper teachers, without a curriculum, without contents of the of education, without the support of fellow classmates, school community, parents, and other support staff, then without these three things, a student is not able to proceed in their course of study.
就像我们啊，选了某一个这个学校啊，然后呢，学校把我们录取了以后呢，我们就是要承诺啊，这个学校给我安排的老师，我一定要啊，把他当作我的老师，我就要好好的跟他学，需要有这样子的承诺啊。然后呢，学校给我安排的课程啊，我要承诺我好好的学啊。然后学校啊安排的这些学生啊。同学啊，我就把他们当作我的这个同学啊，这样子我们每一个这个人啊，每一个学生进去的时候都需要一个这样子的承诺，默认啊，否则的话没办法进这个学校，没办法学习啊。同样的，我们也需要这个啊这样子的条件。
Just as a new student at a school requires.Needs to accept and recognize the teachers at the school, the curriculum at the school, and the school community in order to be considered a legitimate student of that school community. So too do we need to accept some basic criteria.
啊，那我们的老师啊是谁呢？释迦牟尼佛就是我们的老师啊。我们要承诺释迦牟尼佛就是。从今以后就是我的老师啊，这个叫做皈依佛。然后呢，我们要承诺啊，我从今以后跟着释迦牟尼佛干什么呢？就是要好好学佛法啊啊，这个要承诺，这个承诺就叫做皈依法啊。然后我们啊要承诺，凡是学佛的人啊，就是作为我的道友啊，他们都是我的道友，我要承诺他们才是我的道友。啊，学西门外道的人呢，不是我的道友，需要有这样子的承诺。啊、这个承诺啊，就叫做这个啊皈依僧啊。那么我们学佛的时候呢，需要有这个条件啊。我们学佛学释迦牟尼佛的智慧和慈悲心的话，那没有老师怎么学呢？所以我们需要老师啊。虽然有老师，但是没有所学的内容，那又怎么样呢？那我们对我们自己没有用啊，所以呢，需要有这个，需要啊，需要皈依法，法就是这个所学的内容，嗯，然后我们啊，需要其他人的帮助啊，如果没有，尤其是没有僧众的帮助，我们几乎就是没有办法学佛啊，所以啊，我们要承诺，我们依靠释迦牟尼佛。依靠释迦牟尼佛的法，依靠释迦牟尼佛的这个弟子啊，学习啊，这个就是承诺，这叫做皈依。
So the Buddhist refuge really follows this analogy of a student in school. For the purposes of our Buddhist study, our teacher is the Buddha. We rely on the Buddha as our teacher. In terms of our curriculum or teaching content.The Dharma provides this, and we recognize as our classmates, as it were, our fellow students in the Buddhist path as the Sangha, as our spiritual companions. And it's through relying on these three that we, and pledging to rely on these three, that we take refuge in the Triple Gem.
这个承诺非常的重要只要我们这样子承诺了以后呢那就是我们就成为一个标准的佛教徒啊，没有这个承诺啊，那我们就是我们刚才讲的，我们自己遇到一些问题的时候，烧烧香拜拜佛，这个就不叫佛教，不叫标准的佛教徒。所以我们必须要有这样子的这个承诺，才能够成为标准的这个佛教徒。
In the context of refuge, the pledge or the promise is extremely important. It's through taking and making the commitment that we become genuine students of Buddhism. Simply returning to the Buddha and making requests when we encounter a bit of difficulty is not being a true student of Buddhism. It's through making the pledge through refuge that we become genuine Buddhists.
皈依这两个字的字面的内容啊，简单的说，皈依是什么意思呢？就是依靠、依止、依赖啊，这样子的意思。比如说，学生啊，学习的时候要依靠老师啊，依靠他的这个课本啊，依靠他的同学和家长啊，就是依靠他们啊，在这个学校里面学习啊。同样的，我们学佛的时候呢，我们依靠释迦牟尼佛，依靠释迦牟尼佛的佛经，然后依靠释迦牟尼佛的这个弟子啊学习啊，然后就是学习佛法。所以我们要依靠他们啊，不依靠他们，比如说我们也不依靠佛，也不依靠佛经，也不依靠僧众，我们什么都不依靠，我自己去学，怎么学呢？没办法学了，所以就是要皈依。
Refuge, in a nutshell, really means to rely on or depend on the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha. So just as a student relies on his or her teacher, the curriculum, and the school community, so too do we rely on the Buddha and the Buddha's scriptures and the Buddha's students as our objects of refuge.If we are not prepared to rely on or depend on any of these, then how are we going to go about being students of Buddhism?
这三个、啊、对我们的修心，对我们的学习来说一样的重要、啊、三个都一样的重要。比如说没有佛、啊、没有佛那谁来说法，谁来传法，我们学什么呢、啊、所以佛非常的重要了。啊、佛如果虽然、啊、佛出世了，但是佛不转法轮，就像当年释迦牟尼佛成佛以后的七七四十九天、啊、当中佛没有讲法，一句法都没有讲、啊、就像这样子，佛出世了，但是如果佛不转法的话呢，那我们、啊、佛虽然佛出世了，但是我们什么都学不到，我们自己的生老病死的问题解决不了，所以法非常的重要、啊、如果佛出世了传法了，但是这些都是2500多年前的事情，如果没有僧众的话，我们今天的人怎么学呢、啊、虽然佛、这个出世了，但是佛已经远极了，我们亲眼 看不见看不到这个佛、给我们传法的这个、佛啊、然后佛虽然是留下了大量的这个佛经，但是这些佛经我们自己去看也看不懂、嗯、所以、啊、需要这个僧众、啊、僧众尤其是这个传播佛教、啊、这方面呢，我们今天的人学佛是完全都要靠、啊、这个僧众，所以僧众在我们学佛的过程当中起到了最最最关键性的作用，所以我们不靠僧众啊、怎么学佛呢？所以这个都是一样的重要，我们都要靠这些学佛。
In the course of our study of Buddhism, each of the three jewels are equally important. To start with, if we didn't have the Buddha, then we wouldn't have a teacher. It would be, and we wouldn't have an originator of the Buddhist teaching. So in this case, how would it be possible for us to study at all? It wouldn't be. Even if the Buddha hadmanifested, if he had not given teachings, for example, in the first 49 days after his attainment of enlightenment, he didn't speak, he didn't say anything. If there had been no teachings, then the Buddha's manifestation wouldn't have given us the opportunity to study his teaching. So the Dharma is extremely important in this regard.Then even if the Buddha had manifested, he left behind a wealth of teachings, but there was nobody to teach them, there was essentially nobody to impart these teachings to us in our current age, then it would be very difficult for us to properly study the Dharma. In fact, as students of the Dharma today, we're completely reliant on the Sangha, the students of the Buddha, for teaching the Dharma and spreading the Dharma. So we can see that in the course of our Buddhist study, that each of the three gems, the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha, are equally important.
比如说佛法啊，就像啊，好比是一个自来水的水库啊，水库里面的水，然后呢，从释迦牟尼佛到我们自己的这个最根本的上师之前的一代一代的这些上师呢，啊，就像这个自来水的水管啊，水的管道，然后呢，离我们最近的啊，就是也就是我们的根本的上师呢，啊，就像水龙头啊，就像水龙头，那么这些都需要的水，水库里面的水也是很重要啊。然后这个管道也非常重要，但是离我们最近的啊，离我们最近的，我们可以去操作的啊，这个就是水龙头。所以水龙头呢，在这个东这个这些都很需要，但是水龙头离我们啊。最紧的啊，所以呢，这个比如说我们刚才讲的佛法和这个传承的上师，还有我们的根本的上师，这些都很重要。但是呢，离我们最紧的啊，就是像水龙头一样的，是我们的根本的上师。所以呢，上师跟其他的这个僧众，对我们自己而言稍微有点不一样，所以把它分开啊，作为第四个皈依的话。也是可以的，从理论上完全是可以的，但是呢不分开就包含在这个僧众里面也可以的，这个都不矛盾的。所以我们刚才讲了这个四皈依和三皈依其实都一个意思，就是这样子的理由这些都是为什么要皈依的理由。我想这个我们也要了解一下，我念像皈依这样子的最最最基本的基本的这个知识，我们很多人也不知道是我们缺乏了这个系统的佛教的教育所以我们就是不知道，就是不是没有人学法，就是不是没有人想学佛，有很多人想学佛，但是就是因为我们没有这样子的这个教育系统的教育，这样子以后呢，大家都没有办法怎么去，大家都不知道怎么学，大家都很茫然。
We can liken the relationship between the Dharma, the Buddhist scriptures, and the various generations of lineage masters, and ultimately our own teachers to a reservoir of water and a very long pipe.That connects to a faucet from which we access water. We can see the teachings as the reservoir of water. We can see the generations of lineage masters as the pipe, long pipe that connects the water to us. But ultimately, the faucet, the thing that lies closest to us and the thing that allows us to access water is our own individual teacher, our own root master, as it were. So that's why it's possible for us to speak of a fourth object of refuge, one's own guru. But actually, one's guru can also be encompassed within the notion of the third gem, the Sangha. So whether we talk about the three objects of refuge or four objects of refuge is ultimately the same. In any case, I think it's extremely important that we have a clear understanding of the reasons why we take refuge. This is something, given a lack of systematic study, that many people don't have a very clear understanding of. Many people have great interest in becoming Buddhists and studying the Dharma, but are quite often very confused or unclear about how to go about doing it.
近两年这个基督教在东方发展得很不错的发展得很不错很多地方尤其是乡下，很多地方就像中国的很多的乡村都有基督教基督教的各种各样的这个活动，有教堂发展得不错。同样的，我想佛教在西方也有非常大的空间可以发展的因为我想就是佛教的这些真正的这些核心的东西，很多都是西方的这个思想和非常的符合的因为它不会跟这个像科学等等很多东西都是不矛盾的 不但是不矛盾，而且啊，佛教里面讲的啊，很多很多的道理，很多很多的这个最基本的这些观念啊，西方的思想是非常接近的啊。但是呢，我们没有人讲啊，没有人说，没有人传法，没有人去啊说法，没有人讲经说法，没有，就我们缺乏这样子的人才，所以呢，佛教一直都停留在这个书本上啊，就书本一直都停留在这个寺庙里面啊，这是一个我们的佛教的一个最大的问题了。所以大家必须要好好的学习啊，学习，然后呢，我们把这个所学到的东西啊传递给别人啊。当然，我们的这个传播传递的目的啊，必须要建立在利他、慈悲啊、菩提心的基础上。如果没有建立在这个菩提心的基础上，那我们去传播也是没有太大的意义的。
In recent years, Christianity has spread very widely, particularly in Eastern countries, particularly in rural China. Likewise, I think that Buddhism has great scope for further development in the West. One key reason for this being the case is that many of Buddhism's core principles are very much in accordance with Western thought. They don't contravene science, for example, and many Buddhist ideas and principles are actually quite close to many Western ideas too. However, there is a problem that of a lack of qualified people to teach the Dharma and spread the Dharma. So this is something, a problem for Buddhism, that essentially the situation is stalled at a stage where the Dharma exists in the books and exists in the confines of the monastery. So this is something we have to strive to overcome. For this reason, it's important that everyone studies hard and practices hard so that ultimately you will be able to share your knowledge and spread your knowledge among others. Of course, the spreading of the Dharma should be based on an aspiration of benefiting others and compassionate motivation.
好，这个是我们刚才讲的这个第四个，就是为什么要皈依佛教的这个为什么要学佛，为什么要皈依的理由啊。最后一个就是第五是皈依的动机或者是皈依的目标皈依的用佛教的话来讲，皈依的发心发心或者动机就是一个意思那我们为什么要学佛呢佛教里面讲有三种不同的动机，有三种不同的发心那三种不同的是什么最下等的、中等的、上等的三种不同的层次目的就有三种不同的层次。那么这个三种不同的层次，我们首先要搞清楚，然后呢，我们尽量的争取我们的这个皈依的动机，尽量的是上等的上等的这个发心上等的动机。
So, having addressed the reasons for taking refuge, we move on to the fifth point, which is the motivation, our motivation or aspiration in taking refuge. From the point of view of the Buddhist tradition, there are three levels or three scopes of motivation. An inferior motivation, a mediocre motivation, and a superior motivation.It's important that we have an understanding of these different levels of motivation and try as far as possible to make our motivation the superior one.
好，然后呢，我们这个三个动机里面的最下等的是什么呢？就是为了现实生活当中的一些利益，比如说为了健康，为了长寿，尤其是为了发财。为了工作顺利，或者是为了避免一些灾难 这是以这样子的动机，以这样子的发心啊，皈依佛教，可不可以呢？啊，可以皈依佛教，但是呢，这个是最最最啊，最这个下等的啊发心啊，这个发心非常的这个实素，很庸俗啊。我们偶尔有一个这样子的这个发心是没有问题的，可以有的。但是我们一开始学佛的时候啊，整个学佛的目的啊，都是这么庸俗、这么世俗这样子的话啊，这个就是不划算。所以呢，我们啊最好就是我们不要这样子发心。
So to start with, the lowest level of motivation is one that is oriented towards reaping benefits in one's mundane or worldly life, such as longevity, good health, prosperity, or avoiding misfortune and disaster, things like this. While it's okay for us to occasionally have these motivations, if they comprise the totality of our motivation for studying Buddhism, then this isn't a good situation.
然后第二啊，第二个动机就是啊，不是为了现实生活当中的某种利益，而是为了解脱啊，为了解脱。他觉得啊，这个人有生老病死啊，所以我这样子用现在这种状态去这个六转这个轮回是没有什么啊，意义的，我也不能帮助别人，也不能帮助自己，没有什么意义，所以我要解脱，我要超越生老病死啊，就是为了这个啊，皈依三宝。但是呢，啊，他只考虑了自己一个人的解脱啊，他并没有想到要度众生，要让其他众生成佛解脱等等啊，这是为了一个人的解脱，所以这个发心呢，只能是中等的发心啊，因为这个太自私了啊，只懂得考虑自己一个人啊，所以这个是啊不是很好，这个就是小乘佛教的啊，小乘佛教的这个啊动机。那大乘小乘为什么叫大乘小乘呢？啊，小就是要解决自己一个人的问题，所以叫做小。大，他要想解决全天下所有众生的问题痛苦，所以叫做大。这个范围的大和小就是这个意思，所以这是小乘佛教的这个发心。但是呢，他没有为了现实生活当中的名啊利啊，所以他不是最差的啊，就是中等的。
The second level of motivation is not one oriented towards worldly or mundane or common aims in this lifetime. It's one that is born of a disgust and weariness towards cyclic existence and a desire to transcend cyclic existence and achieve liberation. However, this aspiration to achieve liberation is only for oneself. It's an aspiration of individual liberation. It's not an aspiration to achieve liberation for the sake of other beings. So that's why we regard this as a relatively selfish scope of motivation and characterize it as the level of motivation of the lesser vehicle. We distinguish the greater vehicle and the lesser vehicle on the basis of the scope of their motivation. The greater vehicle carries the aspiration to achieve Buddhahood for the sake of all beings, and the lower vehicle, essentially one aspires to achieve liberation for oneself. So because this aspiration is relatively selfishly oriented, we characterize it as the mediocre, the second level of motivation.
好，第三就是发菩提心啊，这个菩提心呢，我们就不需要再重复了，这几天都讲的比较多啊，简单的说一下就可以，简单的说我们今天啊为什么要皈依啊，为什么要受戒呢？啊，我们就是为了帮助啊天下所有的众生啊，利益天下所有的众生啊， 或者是说具体一点的话，说正确一点的话，准确一点啊，那么就是我们要让天下所有众生解脱啊，我一定要去做这个事情，嗯，但是这个事情我怎么能够做呢？现在我没办法做啊，我现在没有这个能力啊，那么怎么办呢？这是我就是要成佛啊，我如果成佛，我能够成佛的话，那我就可以啊，把这件事情我一步一步完全可以做到的。所以呢，我必须要成佛，我一定要成佛啊！从今以后，我的人生目标啊，或者是我的生生死死的，我的生存的目标，生命的意义啊，就是我要为了帮助天下所有的众生而成佛啊，这个就是我的理想，我的梦想啊，我的这个目标啊，就是为了达到这个目标，所以我今天就开始啊，实际行动。我先皈依受戒，然后修禅定，有智慧啊，我一步一步的实际行动啊，这样子发心，这个就叫做菩提心。
The third level, the superior or the highest level of aspiration for taking refuge and taking the precept vows is grounded in bodhicitta. We've discussed bodhicitta a lot, so there's no point in elaborating too much, but essentially bodhicitta entails our aspiration to work for the liberation of all living beings. And it's in order achieve this ability to assist them in liberation that we take refuge tonight, that we take vows tonight. From this point onwards, from this day onwards until we achieve enlightenment, our highest value in life, our greatest goal, the very meaning of our life becomes attaining enlightenment in order to assist and bring greatest benefit to other beings by leading them towards liberation. So this motivation of bodhicitta is what characterizes this third level of aspiration.
好，这以上我们把这个皈依的啊，关于皈依的这个五个方面的问题啊，给大家介绍了。接下来我们啊，再给大家介绍这个居士的五条戒。
So we've now covered the five relevant aspects of refuge. We're going to now move on to talking about the five lay precepts.
那么居士的五条戒啊，是戒定慧啊当中的这个戒啊，有了出离心，在出离心的基础上守哪怕是一条戒啊，也可以的啊。如果能够说无条戒，那就是最最最圆满的啊。但是如果条件不成熟的话啊，守一条戒、两条戒，我相信我们今天在座的所有的人，最少最少完全可以守两条戒啊，两条戒是根本没问题的啊。那么守两条戒也很好的，这个也就是戒定慧当中的戒，我们啊可以说我们已经有了啊，我们已经做到了有啊。然后呢，下一步就是定啊，禅定修心啊，然后修心定中胜回，就是说。有了禅定啊，禅定当中我们就会获得证悟空心的智慧啊，这样子的。所以这个戒啊，戒是非常非常的重要的。受戒有多么多么大的功德，你们啊可以看佛经啊，看佛经啊，这个学院啊里面呢有另外一个这个堪布叫做一席烹措堪布啊。那么他的这个有一本书叫做《走向解脱》啊，《走向解脱》走向解脱有在家和出家啊，在家篇、出家篇。那么这个在家篇这个里面呢，有讲到一些这个戒律的这个受戒的功德啊。除了这个以外呢，《大藏经》我们现在在电脑里面呢可以搜啊，有电子版啊。然后有简体版，有繁体，什么的这个字体都有了啊，非常非常的方便啊！大家看看佛经里面怎么讲，戒律的功德就是不可思议的。大家希望啊去啊了解，但是我们今天因为时间的关系不讲啊， 我们就讲这个，下面我们讲具体的这个这个无条件。
Of the threefold, sequence of precepts, samadhi, and wisdom, the vows that we take comprise the first of these things, the precepts. And after we have taken vows, we can consider ourselves to have fulfilled this first stage. We can then move on to samadhi or meditation. It's said that wisdom is generated from samadhi or meditation, and this refers to a realization of the nature of emptiness. So the merit and the virtue generated by taking vows is inconceivable, it's vast. Based on a proper cultivation of renunciation, the merit and virtue attached to taking vows is really very great, regardless of whether it be one vow or two vows or five vows, the merit is extremely significant. I'm confident that everyone here tonight should be able to take one or two, probably two, of the lay precept vows. We should definitely inform ourselves more about the merit and the virtue of taking precepts. Khenpo Ishipunsok has written a book called Proceeding Towards Liberation. It has versions relevant to ordained people and lay people as well. This is a book that everybody can read. There are also various language versions of the Dazang Jing. In this, we can also inform ourselves about the virtue of taking precepts. In any case, we should be aware that it's a very virtuous action to engage in.
好，然后我们今天啊，守无条节或者是守两条节，是你们自己决定，不是我来安排啊，大家自己决定，大家自己。根据自己的情况来决定无条件和一条件、两条件都可以选啊。这个里面，我们比如说第一条件如果适合自己觉得这个我能做得到没问题那这样子就确定这个时候这条件我要受，要确定。如果觉得第一条件不适合，暂时是没有办法做到这样子的话，那就决定我先暂时不守了，我看第二条节能不能守第二条节能守就确定守第二条节，就是这样子，我们自己决定。
Tonight, in terms of taking the five lay precepts, how many vows and what vows you decide to take is completely a matter of individual choice. It's something that you should determine in light of your own individual circumstances. It's not something decided by me. It's not an imperative given by me. So as we go through the different precepts, you need to assess for yourself whether the precept is something you're able to take, whether it's suitable for you, given the situation of your own individual situation. If it's something that you feel you'll be able to take and able to keep, then you can establish that for yourself. If not, if it's not something you're able to take on for the time being, then you can move on to the next vow and evaluate whether that's something that's appropriate for you.
好，这个无条件当中的第一条节第一条节就是不喝酒不喝酒。就是第一条件大家根据自己的情况，如果能够守就守，不能守的话也可以暂时不守，这个守与不守这个不能勉强，大家自己决定，大家要主动一点这样子才叫做守节，如果不主动被动，这不叫做守节这就不叫做守节。所以呢，第一条件就是不喝酒那么不喝酒，什么叫做酒呢佛教里面对酒的这个定义是什么两个，主要是两个方面。第一个，凡是有酒味的这是第一个。第二个喝多了 能够喝醉人的啊，这是第二个。就这样子的饮料啊，这样子的饮料啊，无论是甜的啊、酸的、白的、红的，都叫做酒。这个就是佛教对酒的定义啊。这样子的饮料就叫做酒。
So the first of the five lay precepts is the injunction against consuming alcohol. This is something that you need to decide for yourself whether or not you are willing to take on. This is something you need to decide proactively. It's very much the voluntary, proactive nature of taking a vow that really constitutes the taking of a vow. In any case, alcohol, for the purposes of the lay precepts, is defined according to two criteria. First, whether or not the substance in question has the taste of alcohol, and secondly, whether it is capable of producing intoxication. And if these two criteria are fulfilled, then the substance is considered alcohol for the purposes of the lay five, for the lay precepts, regardless of the taste of the alcohol, whether it's sweet or sour, or the color of it, whether it's white or red. As long as it is, it has the taste of alcohol and is able to cause intoxication, then it is alcohol.
然后第二个什么叫做喝呢？外用消毒不叫喝可以的甚至是在口腔里面需要用酒精消毒的话，也是可以的也不算喝酒，还有不足够一口，比如说一滴酒滴在口腔里面，也不叫喝酒那么无意当中不知道这个是酒，也不叫喝酒那到底什么是喝酒呢？就是故意明明知道这个是酒，然后就想喝故意喝酒，一口一口的咽下去，叫做喝酒。
Drinking alcohol or its consumption also has its own definition. So topically applying alcohol for antiseptic purposes or even using alcohol as an oral antiseptic is permissible. In terms of quantity, a small drop on the tongue for the purposes of oral medication doesn't constitute consuming or drinking alcohol. Not intentionally consuming alcohol, so unintentionally consuming alcohol when one doesn't know it's alcohol in substance is also not consuming alcohol for the purposes of this precept. Drinking or consuming alcohol is when we are clear that the substance we are drinking is alcoholic and we imbibe it one mouthful at a time.
然后这个比如说我们炒菜的时候用酒料酒，还有些点心还有些药里面也有酒精的成分那么有酒精的成分的这些点心、食物、药，可不可以吃？可不可以喝呢？可以和不可以的界限是什么？如果这个药或者这个食物当中我们吃的时候，这个食物当中的酒精的成分，酒的味道很明显很明显，能够吃出这个酒的味道，这样子的话。那么就是不能吃不能喝如果虽然有一点酒的成分，酒精的成分，但是我们吃喝的时候呢，就是感觉不到就是尝不出这个酒味那这样子就可以喝不叫喝酒可以喝和不可以的界限就是这样子。
And in terms of cooking wines and medicines and desserts that contain alcohol as an ingredient, we draw the line as to what we can consume and what we can't according to whether when we drink or eat the substance in question, we can detect the taste of alcohol. If the taste of alcohol is obvious, if it's discernible, then we can't consume the substance in question. If it's not, then it's okay for us to consume it.
还有啊，我们这个学米的人，学米种的人参加会工啊，那么会工的这个工品里面呢，他们会放一点点酒和肉啊，那么这个酒啊，我们受了这个酒戒的人喝，可不可以喝呢？啊，这个酒也不能一口一口的咽下去，这样子喝，这样子喝的话，那同样的就会犯戒的啊。但是呢，如果我们这个参加了这个会工的话，也不能完全拒绝啊。那这个时候怎么办呢？就是我们表态，我们接受这个啊供品，怎么个表态的方法呢？啊，左手的这个倒数第二个手指叫做无名指啊，无名指沾在这个酒里面啊，沾在酒里面沾一下，然后呢啊，这个手指头上有一点点酒啊，吐在我们自己的嘴唇里面啊，这样子的话，就第一个我没有喝酒就不犯戒，第二个我表态了，我接受这个啊供品啊，这样子就有参加会工的功德一举两得。
There is also some question as to what Vajrayana practitioners who have taken the precept against consuming alcohol should do in the context of the tsok offering and the Ganachakra feast, where meat and alcohol are both present and one is required to consume some of it. In this case, the way that we go about addressing our dilemma, on the one hand, we can't consume the alcohol readily, that would be breaking our precept. On the other hand, not participating in the tzok offering at all is also not something we can do. So we need to find a way of addressing this dilemma. And we do this by dipping the tip of the fourth finger of our left hand in the alcohol and bringing it, touching it to our tongue. And in this way, we are receiving the merit of taking part in the tzok offering, and we are also not breaking our precept against consuming alcohol. So we are fulfilling two ends with the same action.
同样的，比如说我们吃全素的人啊，参加会供的话，那么会供的供品里面呢，也有点点肉啊。那这个肉可不可以吃呢？也是不可以吃的啊，吃全素的人也不可以吃。但是呢，这是既然参加了这个会供的话呢，就是要表态我们接受啊。为什么要接受这些呢？酒肉我们为什么接受呢？我们就是吃这些素的就可以了吗？为什么还要去接受呢？啊，这就是跟禅宗讲的放下有关系的啊。我们把这个比如说水果蔬菜我们认为是干净的啊，我可以接受啊，酒肉之类的是不干净的不清净的，所以我不能这个接受。把清净和不清净的分得清清楚楚，有些东西我接受，有些东西我不接受，这样子的话，那这个就叫做分别念，叫做执着啊，最终是要放下的啊，要放下的啊。但是呢，现在不能放下，现在就放下就混乱啊，所以最终不放下的话，那就是束缚了，束缚到轮回当中解脱不了，最终是要放下的，现在是不能放下的。所以这个把握啊，这个尺度要把握好。所以呢啊，吃全素的人呢，这个时候有一种方法啊，这个是密宗教的方法，是密宗讲的。什么方法呢？我们要表示我要最终我要放下这个清净和不清净的这个执着啊，这个分别念，最终我要放下，我要表态，我今天表态，我最终放下这个啊。但是我现在放不下，我没有这个境界，所以我今天呢啊，我该吃的吃，不该吃的我还是不吃啊。但是我承诺最终我要放下啊，就是这个叫做表态啊。那怎么表态呢？就是密法里面讲，这个会供的肉里面呢， 就去一个很小很小的一块放在嘴巴里面啊，消到什么程度呢？就像一只苍蝇的腿啊，这么小。啊，苍蝇的腿有多小啊？就比一个比我们一根头发啊差不多的啊。那么这啊，有这么一小块放嘴巴里面，那么这根本就不算吃肉啊。但是呢，已经表态了啊，这个吃和不吃不重要，这个态度是最重要的。我就是要表态，我最终要放下这些东西啊。所以这个是有功德，这个也是一举两得。
A similar dilemma arises in the context of consuming meat in the tzok offering. For people who are completely vegetarian, for Buddhists who completely abstain from eating meat, then there is a dilemma about what to do in this context. Of course, first we need to understand the meaning of consuming meat in the context of the tzok offering, what this is really symbolizing or what we are really indicating through our acceptance of meat is our abandoning of dualistic distinctions between pure and impure, clean and unclean. These attachments and dualistic distinctions are ultimately ones that will prevent us from attaining enlightenment. They'll prevent us from overcoming cyclic existence. However, ultimately, at the current stage of our practice, we are not at a point where we are able to abandon these dualistic distinctions. In fact, abandoning distinctions between clean and unclean, pure and impure at this point would only send us into a state of chaos. So what do we do in this situation? Well, what we need to demonstrate is our willingness, an aspiration, a pledge in the future to relinquish our dualistic distinctions. A commitment in the future to letting go, as the Chan tradition characterizes it. And we do this by taking a piece of meat which is extremely, extremely tiny, as fine as the leg of a fly. And we take this very minuscule piece of meat and we put it inside our mouth. And this is how we demonstrate our acceptance of the meat in the context of the tzok offering, and at the same time do not break our vows against or our commitment not to consume meat. And so similarly to the context of making a symbolic acceptance of alcohol in the tzok offering, we achieve two goals with the one action.
好，那么我们刚才讲的这个吃素啊，跟今天我们讲的无戒是没有关系的啊，但是我们就是随便讲一下而已。实际上这个吃素和不吃素跟我们今天的守戒没有关系，它是另外一回事。
Of course, abstaining from meat is not of direct relevance to the five lay precepts that we're discussing tonight. We are only talking about this, discussing this indirectly.
好，我们现在大家就是心里做好准备，这一条戒，第一条戒就是不喝酒。能不能做到？如果觉得可以就我们就确定我要守这条戒。如果暂时因为各种各样的原因，家庭的原因，工作的原因，有很多很多的应酬所以暂时实际上就是不是自己放不下，就是因为环境各方面的原因就比较复杂的如果暂时机缘不成熟的话，那也要确定这条戒我不守。这个收与不收自己决定，心里做好准备。
So everybody, please now assess for yourselves whether the precept against drinking alcohol is something that you are willing to take on. This is something you need to decide for yourselves in light of your own situation. If given your family situation or work situation, the amount of social obligations you have to fulfill, you're not able for the time being to take this vow, then that's your own decision. This is not a situation of you not being willing to give up alcohol, but ultimately your circumstances constraining you from doing so. So everybody, please decide now whether this precept is one you will take.
好，然后呢，我们能够守这条诫的能够守这条诫的，就是不喝酒可以守这个不喝酒的这条诫的我们除了出家人以外的这个居士当中能够守这条诫的，大家举个手，我们看看有多少人可以守。
Aside from the ordained members here tonight, everyone else, members of the audience who are able to take this vow, please raise your hand.
好，非常好，非常好，我们很多人可以守了。好，这是第一条诫然后接下来就是第二条诫第二条诫，我想我们大家都可以守的第二条诫是什么呢？就是不杀人。
So the second precept is the precept against taking a human life or killing a human life.
这个不杀人当中还有一个问题我们要值得注意人成人、婴儿，大家都知道是人还有胎儿算不算人佛教就是算人，胎儿也是人。从国家的法律的角度来讲的话，那么有些国家觉得这个堕胎是犯法，有些觉得不犯法，等等等等各种各样的这个法律。但是从佛教的因果的角度来讲，佛教就认为凡是生命不管他生下来还是在这个母亲的怀胎里都是一样，都是这个生命所以我们故意去杀害的话，那么这个杀死成人和婴儿跟这个胎儿是没有什么区别的，因为这些都是生命而且同样都是人类的生命，所以佛教就觉得这个就是杀生所以这个我们必须要高度重视这个问题。
In respect of the second precept, there's an important point regarding how we define human life. Everybody is clear that adults and children are humans, but we also consider a fetus or a child inside its mother as a human for the sake of this precept. So this has implications in terms of the termination of pregnancy. Different laws of different countries take different approaches as to whether abortion is legal or whether it's illegal. But from the point of view of the Buddhist teachings, from the point of view of karma, the law of cause and effect, then the intentional termination of a fetus is the same as intentionally killing an adult human. So this is something that we really need to pay a lot of attention to.
然后这个堕胎这个问题上呢，基督教也强烈的反对那么佛教呢，就是告诉你反正这个就是杀人凡是杀人是有罪过的但是你非要杀的话，非要堕胎的话，那佛教说我也没有办法，反正我告诉你这个就是杀人。佛教就是这个态度，他以教育为主，告诉大家这什么是善什么是恶善是善恶的因果是什么告诉大家，然后呢大家明白了以后呢自己去决定自己去决定。佛教的作用是教育，让你明白善恶的这个区别明白了以后呢到底做和不做还是要自己决定的自己决定。所以我们在这个问题上呢还是要必须要清楚的，很多人可能也许不清楚所以这个堕胎是属于杀生，而且是属于杀人。
Abortion is something the Christian tradition frequently strongly opposes. The Buddhist tradition takes an approach of education regarding the karmic consequences of terminating a pregnancy. It sees the termination of pregnancy as the taking of life, and not just the taking of life, but the taking of a human life. Ultimately, though, as to whether or not an individual engages in this conduct, this is something for the person to decide. If they absolutely must take a life, if they absolutely must abort a pregnancy, then this is something they decide for themselves. Really, what Buddhism is doing is educating, is informing people as to what is positive conduct, what is negative conduct, and what the karmic consequences of various conduct.
好，然后我们刚才说这个要高度重视啊，怎么样高度重视呢？曾经堕过胎啊，很多人是曾经堕过胎的，所以我们要忏悔啊，忏悔的方式呢，就是修金刚萨埵，就是具备四个对治力的情况下，修金刚萨埵啊，念金刚萨埵啊，念拜字名啊，就可以忏悔，这是一个。另外一个呢？啊，杀生这个罪过，我们可以以放生啊来啊忏悔，也是非常好的啊。除了这个放生和金刚萨埵以外，任何一个善事都可以。比如说，我们为了忏悔啊，我们去啊就这个搞慈善啊，慈善啊，比如说去修学校、养老院。啊，放生等等等等啊，反正任何一个善事，为了这个忏悔罪过去做啊，都有这个清净罪过的作用，都有的。但是这个当中最有效的啊，就是金刚萨埵的修法。
Many people will, over the course of their lives, have aborted pregnancies. And so in terms of what we do in this situation, it's necessary that we repent and that we confess these previous negative karmic actions. And the way that we purify the negative karma and we engage in confession or repentance practice, the most effective way is Vajrayana practice, the recitation of the Vajra Sattva mantra and the 100 syllable seed mantra. We can also, in terms of purifying our negative karma associated with taking life, engage in the releasing of lives. This is also very effective. Or any kind of positive conduct that benefits others, charitable activities, etc., building schools, building retirement homes, etc., all of these things done with the motivation to purify negative dharma and to repent negative karmic actions committed in the past are all possible approaches we can take. But the most effective is Vajrayana practice.
好，第二个高度重视呢，就是当还没有怀孕之前采取措施避孕啊，这个是非常非常重要的。那么采取措施避孕这个有没有罪过啊？有没有一点点罪过？这个我不清楚。但是呢，他可以确定的是，他没有杀生的罪过，因为这个时候还不存在一条生命啊，所以呢。没有这个杀生的这个罪过，所以啊，佛教徒一定要高度重视这个问题啊，因为不信佛的啊，不相信因果的人呢啊，那就是啊，他想要就要，他不想要就打掉，他不当一回事啊，只要对他自己的身体没有问题，很多人不当一回事，但是呢。其实这个不是这么简单的问题，所以必须要高度重视啊！这个怀孕之前啊，采取措施，这个必须要高度重视，这个是没有杀生的罪过的。
In terms of the issue of unwanted pregnancy, it's very important that we as Buddhists diligently practice contraception.Whether or not practicing contraception does have some negative karmic consequences, I'm really not sure about. But one thing I can say for certain is that it doesn't have the karmic consequence or the karmic consequences of taking a life or taking a human life. For people who are not Buddhists and don't subscribe to the law of cause and effect, then whether or not they get pregnant and whether or not they terminate a pregnancy is not something that they really attach too much importance to. However, given the seriousness of terminating a pregnancy for Buddhists, it's very important that we take a diligent approach to practicing contraception.
这样子的话，这个佛教也没有明显的说啊，这个有罪过啊。但是呢，如果怀孕了以后故意去堕胎，那么这个佛教也就觉得这个是罪过，所以呢，佛教也认为这是一个不太好的行为啊。所以呢，这个我们要注意。那么这个问题上大家注意一下的话，其他的应该是没有问题，大家都应该可以守这条戒。
So because of the importance of this, the fact that terminating a pregnancy constitutes the taking of life, it's important that we pay great attention to this. Aside from this one point, taking this precept against killing or taking a human life doesn't have many other or any other complexities. It should be relatively straightforward for everyone to take.
好，然后大家啊，心里做好准备，这条戒如果能够守的话，大家确定啊，我要守这条戒。如果是觉得不合适的话，那也要确定不守这条戒。
So everybody, please now decide for yourselves whether or not this is a precept that you are able to take on. If it's not suitable to your specific life conditions, then that is something you need to decide to.
好，如果啊对，好，接下来我们能够受这条戒的啊，有多少人？我们举个手，我觉得应该大家都可以受的。
Everyone who's willing to take this vow, I'm sure everybody is able to. Please raise your hand.
好，非常好。好，这是第二条戒，然后第三条戒啊，第三条戒是非常非常简单的啊，这个我们在座的所有的人都可以守的啊，那么第三条戒是什么呢？就是为了欺骗啊人，说我有神通啊，然后明明知道自己没有神通啊，没有什么神通，但是呢。为了欺骗人，说我有神通，我能够看到天堂啊，看到地狱啊，看到谁的前世、谁的后世啊，等等等等啊，这样子讲神通的人啊，现在也是不少的啊，也是不少的。所以呢，我们就是如果这样子撒谎啊，就是明明知道自己没有神通啊，知道但是故意撒谎，这样子去欺骗啊。这个是非常严重的撒谎，所以就受这个要下决心啊，从此以后我们不受这样子的妄语啊，这条戒这个很简单，大家都可以守的。
The third precept is one that is very simple and straightforward, and it's one that everybody should be able to take. It is a precept against lying, and lying specifically in relation to making claims about having spiritual attainments and special powers in order to deceive others. These claims are made in the knowledge that one doesn't have these powers, but in order to cheat other people and deceive them, one claims to have various special attainments. These might be powers of clairvoyance, the ability to see into the future, the past, to be able to perceive heaven, hell, all of these kinds of things. In any case, these kinds of lies in relation to the possession of special powers is what's referred to by lying in the context of this precept.
然后如果我们如果自己真的有神通的话，那可不可以说呢？佛教里面就是有明显的规定，如果真的有神通啊，他不是撒谎，真的有神通，那也是两种情况。第一个如果没有什么必要的话，在这种情况下，真的有神通也是不允许讲的啊，不允许讲的。所以大家不要以为这个神通就是佛教的核心，不是的啊，不是的，所以不能讲的。有必要的话啊，没有必要的话是不能讲的。如果有必要的情况下呢，如果真的有神通是可以讲的。
In terms of when one is really in possession of special spiritual powers, then whether or not one can make claims as to having these powers is determined by whether or not there is a real need for you to tell other people about your powers. In the ordinary course of events, when there's no special need, then one is not permitted to speak of one's special abilities. People shouldn't regard the attainment of special powers as the core aspect of Buddhism. It's only in situations where there is a real and concrete need for you to speak of your powers that you are permitted to do so.
那么什么叫做 有必要呢？比如说马航 H370 啊，它没有失踪的头一天，如果你知道的话，允许讲的。但是就是非常遗憾的，就是没有人讲。
So an example of where there might be genuine need for you to speak of your special powers would be, say, in the case of the Malaysian Airlines plane that plummeted into the ocean. If someone with special powers had said so the day before this event happened, then that would be a clear example of this being legitimate. However, it is a great pity indeed that nobody did make such claims.
啊，就是全世界找了一周年，到现在都没有找到。那么就是自称是非常有光大的神通的这些人，应该问问他们啊，他们看他们怎么回答。
One year after this event has taken place, we still aren't able to locate the plane. We don't know where it is. If there are people with real special powers and the ability to see such things, then they should be asked for their.View.
那么这个时候因为它可以救人的人民啊，所以如果头一天知道的话是可以讲，不但是可以讲，而且应该讲啊。还有就是每次我们发生很多很多地震之前，谁都不知道啊，科学也不知道，我们的神通也同样也不知道，这是发生了以后才知道啊。那么这种情况下，比如说这个发生这样子的地震的前一天啊，如果是知道的话，那应该啊告诉大家，应该讲啊，允许讲，不但是允许讲，而且鼓励大家来讲啊。但是也是就是刚才我们讲的非常遗憾的，就是没有人讲啊。所以所有的神通都是我们没有办法确定它是真和假的这些事情上面呢。神通讲的很多很多啊，啊，我们能够确定它是真和假的这种问题上，没有人讲神通啊，所以呢，佛在这些问题上允许讲神通啊，也是没有人讲啊，不允许讲的这些地方呢，我们就是要注意一点，否则的话，这是一个很大的欺骗啊。但是我们一般的老百姓、一般的人，永远都不会讲这样子的神通，所以对我们来说。受这条戒其实不是什么问题。
The case of the Malaysian Airlines plane is one where making claims about one's special powers would be justified because if a person with special powers had predicted the disaster before it happened, then it would have saved countless human lives. And so this is a case not only where speaking of one's powers would be justified, but in fact would be encouraged. This would be the right thing to do. Similarly, in the case of other natural disasters, such as earthquakes, where if one were to predict these events the day in advance, one could help numerous people and save many lives, and this would be the right thing to do. However,The fact is, in such situations where special powers would be of benefit, nobody makes such predictions. In other contexts where making such claims is not appropriate, there are many, many statements of by people who claim to have such powers. In any case, this is something that we need to be careful of. In the ordinary course of events, though, most ordinary people don't go around making claims about their special spiritual attainments, so this should be something that most people are relatively easy to take.
好，然后我们啊，这条戒啊，大家觉得能够守的话，我们要确定啊，守这条戒；如果不能守的话，也要确定不守。
So please decide whether this precept is one that you are able to take or if it is one that you're not able to take.
好，我们能够守这条诫的，大家举个手，这是。
Please raise your hand if you're able to take it.
好，非常好，大家都可以守了。好，这样子就好了。我们啊，我建议我们今天在座的当中啊，年轻人，或者是还要去上班啊，做生意，需要养家糊口的啊，就建议大家就守这三条诫啊。这三条诫呢，不影响我们的工作，也不影响家庭的生活啊。然后也守了三条诫或者两条诫，已经是非常不错了。
I would suggest that most people here tonight, particularly young people here tonight, take these three vows tonight. Simply, these three precepts in themselves are already a very good achievement. Those of you who are still holding down a job, have household responsibilities, etc., would be also advised to take these three vows.
还有两条诫啊，剩下的还有两条诫，一共是五条诫，那还有剩下两条诫。那么两条诫呢？年纪比较大一点的啊，稍微比较年纪大一点的人守这两条诫是比较容易不会犯，比较适合的啊。那么这两条诫是什么呢？第一个。就是不偷盗，不偷盗，就是不偷别人的东西。
So there are two remaining precepts of the total five. And of everyone here tonight, it's people of relatively senior age who would be most suited to taking these other two precepts. The first of these two precepts is the precept against stealing.
那么偷盗呢，我们很多人想偷盗，我们也不偷啊，我们是很文明的社会，我们不会偷东西啊。是啊，我们一般人的概念当中的这个偷东西我们不会去偷的，但是呢这个就是有点复杂啊，比如说偷税漏税也是偷盗啊，这个我们能做到吗？我想可能有些人还做不到啊。还有就是我们比如说反正我们总而言之啊，该付的费用啊，任何一个费用啊，我故意不付的话，那么这样子就会犯戒的。
Most people might think that stealing or taking the precept against stealing is not something that would be difficult for them. After all, they're a civilized law-abiding person who doesn't think that taking other people's things is proper. However, in terms of this precept, the definition of stealing is slightly complicated. Stealing in respect of this precept extends to evading taxes, for example, or avoiding the payment of any fees that one is due to pay.
然后这个偷盗啊，价值足够多少钱啊才算偷盗呢？就像中国大陆啊，就是根据现在的物价、现在的这个人民币的这个价值啊来衡量的话，就大概就是十块钱左右，十块钱的人民币啊就会犯戒的啊。那么在其他地方呢啊，每一个国家每一个地方的物价。和他的这个货币的这个价值啊去算啊，就知道是多少钱啊，你们自己去算啊。那么就是超过了这个价值以后呢就会犯戒的，所以比较这个比较复杂，还是不熟的话比较安全。
In terms of the amount of value of an object, the taking of which would constitute stealing, this amount in Chinese currency would be approximately 10 renminbi, and whatever the corresponding equivalent is in the currencies of other countries. So because this amount is relatively small,it's one that is easy to break, and so most people would probably be better off not taking this precept against stealing.
当然，如果我们就 觉得这个没有什么做不到，要守啊，那当然很好了。如果我们守三条戒和守四条戒的功德是不一样的啊，如果能守当然是很好的。
Of course, if it's something that you are willing and able to take, that's fantastic, that's great. There is a discrepancy, a difference in the merit between taking two precepts and four precepts.
所以我对，如果自己想守的话呢，啊，自己心里确定要守就可以，这个我们不拘守。
whether or not this is something you are willing and able to take, decide for yourselves, decide in your own mind, we are not going to raise our hands on this one.
啊，这是第四条戒了，啊，然后第五条戒，啊，第五条戒就叫做邪淫，啊，什么叫做邪淫呢？主要是迫害别人的家庭，啊，但是呢，不仅仅是这一点，还有其他的内容，啊，所以大家先，啊，学习一下，然后学习好了以后呢，如果觉得没有问题，啊，到时候下一次可以补手，啊，可以补就可以补充就可以了，啊，然后有觉得有问题的话就不受啊，学习了以后，但是因为我们今天没有讲得很清楚，所以呢，我就建议你们不太清楚的话就不要守这条戒。
The fifth precept is the precept against engaging in sexual misconduct. And in terms of what sexual misconduct refers to, primarily it refers to engaging in extramarital affairs. But the entire content of this precept is broader than this. So this is something that we need to inform ourselves about in greater detail before we take this precept. And since many people might not be clear about what scope of this precept entails, I would advise most people not to take it.
那我们到哪里去学呢？就是看像宗喀巴大师的《菩提道次第广论》，还有大圆满的前性啊，普贤上师言教这些里面呢都讲了这个私家心的。因果不续啊，这个里面也讲了，然后慧灯之光里面呢也讲了，也讲了一些现代的问题，都讲得比较清楚的，大家看书就知道了啊。那么到时候如果觉得可以就可以受啊。
This is something that we can inform ourselves about by consulting Tsongkhapa's Stages of the Path to Enlightenment or the words of my perfect teacher.Also, in the Wisdom Light book series, I explain this precept in relation to contemporary social issues. So, after having informed oneself as to the content of this vow, we can decide whether or not we're willing and able to take it.
但是65岁、70岁以上的人可以守的，今天守也可以的，没有问题的。
But those of us here tonight who are age 65 and above can take it with no problems.
好，这个我们也不举手了。
But we're not going to raise our hands on this one either.
好，这样子我们把五条戒给大家介绍清楚了。我接下来我们准备守戒。首先大家站起来向释迦牟尼佛的佛像磕三个头。
So now we have outlined the five precepts. Everybody, please stand up.
出家人都坐坐坐，听他们出家人都不起来，大家请坐下来。好，其他人我们磕三个头。
Everyone except for those who are ordained, please make three prostrations before the Buddha.
向释迦牟尼佛的佛像磕三个头。听到吧，向参摩罗过，向参摩罗过，就就就，对对对，听到吧，向参摩罗过，就就就就就，好，磕了三个头以后呢，大家跪下来，不要坐到座位上，大家跪下来，向释迦牟尼佛的佛像前，大家跪下来，两手合掌。 And
everyone, please kneel after having prostrated three times and bring your palms together.
好，然后我们啊准备收结。那么我们收结的时候，大家必须要全神贯注啊，大家必须要用心去收啊，否则的话，我们光是啊这个衣柜啊，我们口头上念一下是得不到解，所以大家一定要专心啊啊！所以我再重复一遍，我们刚才讲的这些简单的再重复一遍啊。我们现在收结就是有三个步骤，第一个步骤我们要发菩提心，大家要啊发菩提心，我们就啊大家发心，我一定要让天下所有众生。我一定要让他们成佛，为了做到啊这件事情，我要成佛，为了成佛啊，我要这个收居士戒和皈依戒啊，这样子发心。
So it's very important when we take the vows that we do so paying proper attention with proper sincerity in our hearts. Simply reciting the words of the liturgy is not a true taking of the vows. There are three stages to the taking of vows. We begin by generating the aspiration of bodhicitta, which is in order to assist and benefit all living beings in achieving liberation. I tonight take refuge vows and the five lay precepts or the number of precepts we're going to take.
好，第二个步骤呢，就是皈依。刚才是发心，发菩提心啊。第二个步骤就是皈依。皈依的时候呢，我们现在啊，很庄严的、严肃的下决心：我从现在起，生生死死，释迦牟尼佛作为我的唯一的导师。啊，释迦牟尼佛的法作为我的唯一的所学所修的法，然后呢，学释迦牟尼佛法的僧众作为我的唯一的道友，啊，这样子，这个下决心宣誓，这个是第二个步骤，皈依。
The second stage is the taking of refuge, and this entails us.Taking refuge in the Buddha as our only spiritual guide, taking refuge in the Dharma as our only spiritual teachings, and taking refuge in the Sangha as our only spiritual community.
啊，我们有些老年人呢，就是跪，如果腿不方便的话，可以坐到座位上，没问题的。
If there are some elderly members of the audience who for whom it's not comfortable to kneel, then feel free to sit.
好，第三个呢？第三个步骤呢，就是我们啊收结。我们比如说我们刚才啊发心收了三条结，这样子的话，那我们现在啊在释迦牟尼佛的佛像前宣誓：我从今天起到死为止啊，不喝酒，不杀人啊，不说我们刚才讲的这种妄语啊，不但是不做这些事情，而且。我受这三条戒啊，这样子，这个下决心。
And the third stage is the taking of the precepts. So, in respect of the precepts we are willing to take, we make the pledge, the sincere and solemn pledge that from this day onwards until the end of this lifetime, we will not engage in.The various conducts of the precepts that the precepts we are going to take prescribe. Not only will we not engage in these kinds of negative conduct, we take the vow against engaging in these things.
好，然后呢，我们把这三个事情啊，要在释迦牟尼佛的佛像前，把我们的意思要表达。表达的方法呢？啊，就是有一个衣柜啊，这个衣柜我们念三遍啊，念三遍的最后一遍结束的时候呢，我们每个人就获得两种戒，一个就是皈依戒，另外一个是居士戒。
And before the image of the Buddha, we undertake, we make this undertaking and. through reciting as a symbol of our taking or our willingness to take the vows, we recite the liturgy. And at the completion of the liturgy, everyone here will have received two kinds of vows. First, the refuge vow, and secondly, the lay precept vow.
好，我们现在准备念这个仪轨。念仪轨呢，我先念一句，大家跟着我念一句，我们这样子重复三遍。
And the way we're going to recite the liturgy is that I will recite one line first, and then you will repeat after me, and each line we will repeat three times.
好，大家跟着我念啊，就是我们不懂念这个念中文的呢，也就是念这个音啊，我念的这个音，念这个声音啊，内容呢，就是我们刚才讲的这些内容，就是自己想啊。我就是要受这三条戒或者几条戒，心里下决心，然后念这个仪轨，要知道我在说什么就可以了。
For those who don't understand Chinese, then it's okay just to repeat the sound of the lines that I speak. The content of the liturgy is exactly that which we have outlined tonight, the refuge vows and the lay precept vows. So whilst you're repeating after me,keep in your mind the precepts that you intend to take.
好，请大家跟着我念。
Everyone, please repeat after me.
大德一心垂念我。
大德一心垂念我。
要说出自己的名字啊。呀，要说出自己。
Please say your own name here.
我名。从此时起，终身皈依佛，两祖尊，皈依法，立与尊，皈依僧，众种尊，请达德。从此时起。乃至终身时至，设我为居士。好，这是第一遍，再来第二遍。大德一心垂念我，
大德一心垂念我，
我名，从此时起，终身皈依佛。两祖尊，皈依法，立与尊，皈依僧，众种尊，请达德。从此时起，乃至终身时至，设我为居士。好，这是第二遍，再来最后一遍。大德一心垂念我，
大德一心垂念我，
我名，从此时起，终身皈依佛，两祖尊，皈依法，立与尊。皈依僧，众种尊，请达德。从此时起，乃至终身时至，设我为居士。好，然后我说此乃方便的时候，大家要说善哉啊，此乃方便。好，非常好。然后还有一个衣柜啊，还有一个衣柜，我们要重复一遍就可以了，要重复一遍。那念这个衣柜的时候呢，我们要发心啊。我们刚才守了五条戒、三条戒、两条戒啊，那么这个戒守了以后呢，我们要这个护持这个戒，就是要持戒啊。那我们怎么持戒呢？我们啊，向过去的阿罗汉学习啊，阿罗汉就是过去的。大的成就者， 高僧大德成就者，我们向他们学习，他们怎么持戒，我们就怎么持戒啊，这样子发心，然后就跟着我念啊。
There's now another short liturgy that we're going to recite, and this relates to how we go about keeping or upholding our vows now that we have taken them. And the way that we will do this is by following in the example of the Arhats of the past. We will follow their example in upholding their precepts.
好，大家跟着我念。Yeah.
Everyone, please repeat after me.
愿是垂念我，
愿是垂念我，
往昔圣者阿罗汉，
往昔圣者阿罗汉，
如何断除杀生，
如何断除杀生，
而不杀生，
而不杀生，
如是，
如
是，我名，
我名，
宜从此时起。
乃至终身
时
至，
断除杀生，
而不杀生，
我以此意志，
向圣者阿罗汉，
至学处，
虽修，
虽学，
虽
作。此外，往昔圣者阿罗汉，如何断除？好，这个时候我们刚才没有受不偷盗的，大家补念啊；受了不偷盗的，就跟着我念啊。
The next one, those who did not take the precept against stealing, please don't repeat here. However, those who are taking this precept, please repeat after me.
盗取，然后我们没有受这个不邪淫的这条戒的，大家都不念，受了不邪淫戒的跟着我念。
And now those who are not taking the precept against sexual misconduct, please don't repeat after me. Those who are, please repeat after me.
邪淫。好，然后大家一起啊，这个我们所有人一起。
And the next line, everyone can please repeat after me.
妄语。好，然后我们没有收不喝酒的，大家不念，收了。不喝酒的，酒节的，跟着我念。
Those who are taking the refuge against consuming alcohol, please repeat after me. Those who aren't, there's no need to.
古酒，纠纷，能嘴，方意至无。好，然后大家一起啊，所有人一起。
Everyone, please repeat this.
如是，我名。宜从此时起，乃至终身时至。好，然后我们不偷盗的跟着我念啊。
Those who are taking the refuge against stealing, the precept against stealing, please repeat after me.
不盗，然后就是不邪淫的啊。
And this is for those who are taking the precept against sexual misconduct.
不邪淫，然后所有人啊。
And everyone can repeat this.
不妄语，
不妄语，
然后就是不喝酒的啊。
This is for those who are taking the precept against consuming alcohol.
不饮沽酒，
不饮沽酒，
纠纷，能嘴，
能嘴，
方意至无，
方意至无。
然后呢，如果我们守了五条戒的话，要说。我以此五指，三条戒就说我以此三指，如果是两条戒的话，要说我以此两指。
Here we repeat this line depending on the number of vows we've taken. So if we're taking five, we say five. If we're taking three, we say three.
我以此五指，向圣者阿罗汉。
至学处，
虽修
虽
学
虽做。
好，然后我说此乃方便，大家说善哉啊，此乃方便。好，非常好，大家站起来向释迦牟尼佛磕三个头，然后坐回去。
Everybody, please, rise and make three prostrations before the Buddha.
好，向释迦牟尼佛磕三个头。好，磕了三个头以后呢，大家坐回去，不需要跪。
And after you have made the prostrations, please sit back down.
好，然后我们这个居士的无条戒和居士的无条戒呢，我们讲的比较清楚了啊。接下来我们这个皈依节还没有讲，我简单的给大家介绍一下这个皈依节，然后呢大家进一步的去看像大圆满的前行普贤上师研究，还有就是像这个菩提道次第光轮回灯之光都可以，这些里面都有讲啊。但是因为我们今天收集了，我要简单的介绍一下。
In respect of the advice for taking the refuge vows, I'm going to introduce some points briefly now. In order to inform yourselves about it in greater detail, then please consult the gradual stages of the path and the words of my perfect teacher and the Wisdom Light book series.
然后我们这个皈依戒呢一共有六条戒我们需要去做的要三条戒不可以做的方面呢也有三条戒，一共有六条戒。
In respect of taking refuge, there are six objects of action. Three of these are objects to shun, and three of them are objects to practice.
好，第一条呢自从我们皈依了佛以后这个要恭敬佛不单是恭敬佛，也要恭敬佛像不单是恭敬佛像，连佛像的一个碎片都要恭敬，比如说一个泥塑的佛像破碎了以后连这一个碎片都要恭敬，比如说我们在不干净的地方就发现已知佛的这佛像的手指头这样子的时候呢，我们把它拉上来先搁在自己的头顶，这就是表示恭敬然后呢就找一个稍微比较干净的地方就放在那里就是要这样子，总而言之就是要恭恭敬敬的就可以了这个很简单，大家都能做得到。
So the first thing that we need to do is to show respect to all representations of the Buddha. So this includes all statues, paintings, and artistic depictions. Even a fragment of a Buddha statue, we should show respect and deference towards. So if we found, for example, the broken finger of an earthen Buddha statue on the ground, then we should pick it up and touch it to the crown of our head as a sign of respect.
第二个，我们自从皈依了佛法以后呢，要恭敬佛法这里佛法指的是主要是佛经我们把这个佛经看完了、念完了以后呢，放在比较干净的地方要恭恭敬敬的不单是要恭敬佛经，连佛经上的一个字都要恭敬不能放在地板上，脚不能踩。不能放在屁股下面等等，总而言之就是要恭恭敬敬的，这是第二条戒。
So the second object to practice is showing respect to, well now we have taken refuge, we need to show respect to the Dharma. And this applies particularly to the Buddha sutras, the Buddha scriptures. So in addition to after we read the Buddhist scriptures, putting them away properly in an appropriate and clean place, we should even show respect to one word, a single word, a single letter from the Buddhist scriptures. So this means being careful with where we put the Buddhist scriptures, putting them in high places, clean places, not sitting on them, not stepping on them.
第三条节就是自从皈依了僧众以后呢，我们要恭敬僧众，不单是恭敬僧众，连僧众的僧衣袈裟这样子的这个僧衣都要恭敬，这是第三条节。这三条节都很简单，大家都做没有什么困难。
And the third object of practice is now having taken refuge, it's necessary we show respect to members of the Sangha. So it's important that we show respect to all people with monastic vows, and not only their persons, but also their robes.
然后后面的三个就是不可以做的方面有三个。第一条是我们自从皈依了佛法自从皈依了佛以后不能向鬼神磕头不能向跪下来鬼神磕头。意思就是说佛教徒不崇拜鬼神不崇拜鬼神，所以不能向鬼和神，神就是像我们民间说的很多很多各种各样的神都叫做神但是不能跪下来磕头比如说有些时候上香鞠躬这些应该是可以的。
So the first of the three objects to shun is having taken refuge in the Buddha, we cannot worship, show deference to gods and spirits. So this means that we cannot kneel down and make prostration, say, to gods and spirits, of which there are many in various folk traditions. Making simple bowing gestures or simple incense offering shouldn't be a problem, though.
然后向祖先磕头这个是可以，这个因为跟信仰没有什么关系的，可以的。然后呢，向父母磕头呢佛教里面也是非常非常的这个重视，对父母的孝顺都是没有问题的。
Making prostrations to ancestors is not a problem because this doesn't have bearing on religious faith.And similarly, making prostrations to one's parents is not problematic. The Buddhist tradition very much emphasizes respect to one's parents.
第二条戒呢，我们自从皈依了佛法以后第二条戒就是去不能故意的去伤害众生这个难度有点大。我们刚刚学佛我们刚刚学佛的时候就不去做任何对其他的众生有害的事情这个很难做到，这个几乎就是不太可能的。但是呢，大家要尽量大家要尽量。如果我们无意当中，或者是实在是没有办法的情况下去做了一些对众生有害的事情，那么我们要忏悔要高度重视，要告诉自己以后不再去做等等，以这样子的方式来忏悔。总而言之，大家要尽量。
The second object to shun is intentionally harming other living beings. This is something, particularly in the beginning stages of our practice, is something quite difficult to do. However, it's something that we should, as far as possible, strive not to do. When we do undertake some kind of action or conduct that has harmful consequences for other beings, then we should confess this, we should repent this, we should make the aspiration henceforth not to engage in this conduct. At least the second object is something that we should do our best to observe.
其他的我们伤害众生的这些事情呢，我们可以尽量，但是呢，也有一个底线底线是什么呢？就是故意杀害众生故意杀生亲手杀生这个不可以的。所以呢，我们拍蚊子呀， 去采蟑螂啊等等啊不喜欢的这些动物，也不能故意的去这个杀害。但是呢，无意当中，比如说走路的时候不小心踩死蚂蚁，或者是开车的时候不小心碾死小动物等等啊，这些无意的是没有太大的这个罪过，就是最低的限度啊，不能故意杀害众生。
There is, however, a minimum requirement with regards to the non-harming of other living beings. One thing we cannot do is take the life of other living beings. So this includes not swatting mosquitoes, squashing cockroaches, and deliberately harming other small animals. If we unintentionally or in a situation when we're not aware of what's happening, squash animals when we're walking and things like this, then this is not included within this object. However, the basic minimum requirement is that we cannot kill other living beings.
还有跟这个杀害众生的生命有直接关系的就是吃肉啊。那么尽量的大乘佛教尽量的吃素，如果实在是不能吃素的话，那不能吃素是不是等于就是不能学佛呢？也不是，也没有那么严重，但是呢尽量的这个吃素啊，但是这个也有一个底线，最低的限度啊，最低的限度也就是不能去吃火的啊，不能去吃火的，要吃的话也就只能吃冰冻的啊，不能去吃火的。
And the injunction against harming other living beings in terms of eating meat, we should do our best as far as possible to abstain from eating meat, to be vegetarian. However, this doesn't mean that if one isn't vegetarian, then one can't be a Buddhist. The minimum requirement here is that one cannot eat or consume beings that are alive. If one is going to consume meat, it needs to be meat that has already been killed and is prepared in this way.
最后一条就是我们自从皈依了僧众以后，我们只参加佛教的佛事活动，不参加外道的其他宗教的这个宗教的活动但是呢，佛教在这个宗教的包容方面呢，应该是做的是最好之意所以呢，就是要尊重所有的人的信仰，要尊重所有的这个宗教，任何一个宗教都不能毁谤不能诽谤。不能这个排除不能歧视如果去诽谤的话就是会犯迷尘戒，会犯这个菩萨戒但是呢学习的时候呢因为我们选择了佛教，就只学佛教不参加这个外道的这个宗教的活动。
And the third object that we're not to engage in is participation in the religious activities of other religious traditions. The Buddhist tradition in general is extremely tolerant of other religions, and by all means we should respect other religious traditions. We should not slander other religions. We shouldn't discriminate against people with other religious faiths. In fact, doing so would constitute breaking the tantric vows and also the bodhisattva vow. However, since we're students of Buddhism and we've made a choice to follow the Buddhist path, then we we are not students of other religious traditions.
今天我们受了皈依戒，然后呢就是受了这个居士戒，这是一个非常非常大的善根这个我们一定要好好的回向，要回向给天下所有的众生天下所有的众生以此功德暂时能够愉快 心腹，然后健康，最终大家都能够往生西方极乐世界，或者是成佛解脱这样子，以这样子的心态我们做回向。
So now we are going to dedicate the merit of having taken the refuge and precept, lay precept vows tonight. In doing so, we dedicate our merit to other beings that they may receive the benefits, the temporary benefits of health and happiness, and the ultimate benefit of liberation, the achievement or the attainment of Buddhahood,and rebirth in Amitabha's Pure Land. And it's with this aspiration that we dedicate our merit from tonight's activities.
So nam dayi tanja zumba nya do ne ni be dana bang je ja je ga na che wa mo zumba zhe bim zo len zho wa zho wa shu Om Ahom Banzer Bama Soda Om Ahom Banzer Bama Soda Om Ahom Banzer Bama Soda谢谢谢谢谢谢大家阿弥陀佛。